Here at the European Women Payment Network, I'm talking to Rikke Staer, and she's from a company called Coinify, who just got recognized because of diversity. We're first going to talk about why she joined the network, then about her company, which is in the payments, in the blockchain and crypto, and then what's her personal story. So Rikke, why are you here at this European Women Payments Network?
Well, I got invited to join one of the panel discussions around women and including women more in the global payments. And I thought this is a super interesting topic to be part of, and I would like to contribute to help women in general and try to be a role model, because I had some strong female role models previously in my career. And now I feel like, you know, now I also need to take on that a little bit, that job myself, as now I have one of the management team in a startup. Uh-huh. And we have quite a lot of young females joining the team, so I am definitely the most experienced on the female side, and I feel like now I have an obligation to also show to them, you know, what it takes to be a role model in this industry. I find it, you know, a bit scary, as I think a lot of women do, but at the same time I appreciate the women who have been a role model to me, and now I feel like, okay, now I also need to contribute myself if I do truly believe that we can help each other if we work together as women.
Yeah, we're first going to talk about Coinify, who's doing everything right, and then we're going to talk about London, who did everything bad. So that's really, that story is much more interesting, but okay, let's talk about Coinify. What does Coinify do?
So Coinify is a crypto and virtual currency payment system where we allow people to buy and sell virtual currencies on our platform, and we also have a service that allows for online shops to accept virtual currencies as payments. Yeah.
So and then you immediately transfer them without they can immediately turn it into crypto into fiat currency.
Correct.
And how many clients do you have?
So on the trade platform we have about 800,000 clients, and on the merchant side we have about I would say 10,000 active merchants.
So okay. So that's quite a bit, yeah. And 800,000, is it very international? Because you're in Denmark, right?
Yeah.
Is it very international, or is it more Scandinavian, or?
No, so on the trade side, it's in Europe. We only open it for European customers, so the Scandinavian market is quite small. I would say the big European countries like Germany, France, and UK are our biggest geographical areas. And on the payment side, it's global. So we accept any merchants from anywhere in the world, except for sanctioned countries, obviously.
Okay. How many people work there?
Sorry, about 40 people.
40 people, and how long do you exist?
Since 2014.
Okay, how many women are working at the company?
So we have 45% women.
45% women.
Yes.
How many are in the management team? How many people in the management team and how many women?
So there's 4 people in the management team and I am the only woman in the management team. So 25% of the management team.
And it was started by?
2 men.
2 men, but they're doing a good job in being diversity. Or is that more normal in Denmark?
Well, I think definitely it is more normal in Denmark, but we have also made a conscious decision. So we were about 15 people when I joined, but then towards the end of last year, we saw this big boom in the industry and we gathered a lot more momentum. So we needed to hire a lot more people. And then we made a conscious decision to actually try and think diversity into the hiring phase.
Was that your idea or was that the two founders' idea?
Well, I definitely put the idea forward, but they were also very pro this idea and has helped fulfill this now. So
you need a lot of hands quickly.
We did, indeed, yeah.
And how did it work out to have a lot of women coming in the company? Did that change the atmosphere? Did that change the culture?
I think so. It did, and definitely. I mean, in the tech department, as you can guess, we only have 2 women, so still predominantly men there. And then we have more women in the operations, compliance, marketing, and so on. The traditional
women are wonderful for regulation. They are really good in compliance, regulation. Also at the central banks and at the regulators. There's always lawyers. There's always
that seems to be really
correct.
You know.
Well, I think there are some strong women in technology, but there are fewer of them. And then also the competition to get their attention is harder, right? And we're competing with some of the big banks that also want to develop their blockchain area. So the few developers that are available in Denmark actually go at a very high going rate, in my opinion.
Everybody wants technical women on their team. Now, let's first talk, before we get to your personal experience in London.
Yes.
Let's talk about the challenges you have. I mean, we had this morning also a team, mostly women. About legislation and the fifth directive of money laundering, that all the crypto exchanges will be regulated.
Yes.
Did you already prepare for that, or did you write the legislation, or what's your involvement with that?
Yes, very much. So from the beginning in 2014, when Coinify was founded, we asked the Danish FSA, you know, can you help us here? And they couldn't. But
they could not?
No, they could not. They didn't know. They just said it's not illegal, so but we don't know what.
Same in Holland. We have no idea. Yeah.
Exactly. So we've been keeping in regular contact with the regulators, because we want to understand every time we take a new step, a new product and so on, if we're doing everything correctly. At the same time, we joined with other people in the industry in Europe, also some Dutch companies, and formed this working group where we we invite on a monthly basis some members of European Parliament in to ask them about certain regulation, but also to inform.
Very forward thinking.
Yeah, correct. And it's working so far very well. So we had a big hand to play in the AML D5, which came out in December last year, and which is now sent to all of the member states.
Yeah.
So the Danish government is now interpreting it, and we expect the legislation to come out towards the end of this year or Q1 next year.
Okay, so how dramatic will that be? I mean, is it just the KYC that has to be done at a certain level? Or is it also involving the crypto, that you have to prove that the crypto comes from a certain place?
So it will both be on the AML side, so understanding who's the identity of the person who's buying, but it's also the source of funds and source of wealth. So on the source of funds sides, the banks are now asking, you know, why do you have 10 million or just 10,000 euros?
Yeah.
Okay, I sold my flat. Okay, fine, show me a proof. Now, on the crypto side, it's a lot easier, actually, to document where you have it from, because you can trace everything electronically where it's been. So if I say, you know, I have it from, you know, I mine, you know, I'm a mining machine, then I can go in and verify it's actually mining. But I can also see if it's been given the other wallets, and some of them traded on the darknet and so on, and then I can say as a company, I don't want to deal with your coin to be on the darknet, so I send it back.
So your responsibility. Has this Bitcoin ever been used on the darknet? And you can do that.
Correct. So I need to now verify, where do you have your funds from? It's the same way as the bank is asking you, where do you have then cash? You have no clue, right?
Yeah.
I don't know if you sold. Okay, it's fair enough to sell hash in Holland now, so it's a bad example. But in Denmark, it's not legal, but people still do it, right? But I never know if you hand me 100 euros. I don't know if you did something illegal to obtain.
Well, if you come with a bunch of cash, it's anywhere from it's illegal anyway. I mean, if you have a suitcase of cash, it doesn't work anymore.
Correct.
Okay, so you don't think it's going to be a big hurdle for you?
It is doable.
It is doable, yeah. But that's been for a long time. So even though we weren't under the legislation, we've been kind of pretending that we were. So we've been doing all of these checks and writing the internal policies for a long time.
What amount of money does it start? If I buy 1,000 euro, it doesn't happen probably. But if I do 10,000 or 100,000, where at what point are you going to ask me, where did you get the money?
Yeah, at 10,000 euros. So that's the same as the current banking legislation, but we'll ask you, where do you have it from? And give me the proof of where you have it from. So at it from. So euros, we ask you, where do you get it? And 10,000, we ask you,
So at 10,000 euro, that is the starting point?
Correct.
And that is the same as with the bank. And you say at 3,000, what do you do at 3,000?
No, at 3,000 we ask you, where do you have the money from? And then at 10,000 we ask you to give us a proof. So give me a screenshot. Okay, I bought them on an exchange. Okay, just print out a screenshot and show us we bought them here. Or the same as, okay, I sold my old car and I made some money on it. Okay, just give me a printout of the receipt that you sold it, and I can see you. That's where you have your money from.
So you don't think it's going to be very difficult?
I mean, I think for a new company starting up, I think it will be big barrier to entry.
Well, there will be tech companies who will solve that problem, right?
Yeah, but you also need to have the transaction monitoring in place. So looking at odd transaction patterns. So say you always told me, you know, I can afford to pay 100 euros a month in crypto, but suddenly you make a huge transaction. So then it will look odd to me, because what I know about you is that you normally don't have so much money, so you spend little by little each month or something along those lines.
Okay.
So we need to put in place these monitoring systems as well, where we flag odd transaction patterns. And obviously an odd transaction pattern doesn't necessarily mean that you're doing anything illegal.
You just need to prove that it doesn't. Okay,
exactly.
So that's good to know.
Yes.
Hey, how are you surviving the current crypto winter, after going to such a boom in December?
So, Coinify, like everybody else in the industry, was completely overwhelmed with last year, November, December. Yeah. I mean, hand on heart, I felt like maybe we even need to shut down the company because, like, overwhelming success. There was just so many people. We couldn't cope with it. You know, we couldn't approve KYCs fast enough. We couldn't answer the tickets fast enough and all of these things because we weren't so many people.
It was terrible.
Yeah. And also too many.
Now?
And now I felt like it's been nice that, you know, it's been slowly decreasing. We've gotten a lot more people hired. We have the processes in place. And it has allowed us to look at, you know, actually going after some target markets now. Before, everything just came over our heads. And now we can have a strategy and say, okay, we want to work with these wallets and these wallets. And then
for you, really, it doesn't matter. As long as there's trades,
exactly.
You make money. It doesn't matter at what level it happened.
No, so Coinify doesn't hold any crypto ourselves. So we're not exposed to the volatility. We just facilitate the trades. So on a daily basis, we get payments coming in from payment and people selling coins, and then we have people buying. And then we match it all up. So we don't hold any cryptos, and you cannot hack us and steal a lot of cryptos. So
no wallets. Okay.
Yeah.
Now let's talk about the third thing. Does your management team in Denmark, does it go having beers and until late at night or on the golf course? Where policy is really decided?
No, not at all.
Okay. So where do they do that?
So in London, I was 7 years in London working at a large corporation in Canary Wharf. And here I was part of a management team, which was all male. Yeah. And everybody had a wife at home who was taking care of the kids and sorting everything out, which was great for them. But I live the most Scandinavian lifestyle with a full-time working position and manage like a big team of 25 people and then two very young kids.
Yeah.
And I was very determined that I wanted to succeed, also being in London, but it did have some challenges because, as you mentioned, a lot of business is done after work in London, it turned out, and a lot of things at the pub where people are just hanging out and then discussing some things, and it could be slightly frustrating coming in the next day and then having a meeting where I thought we were going to decide something, but it was already decided. That was very clear because everybody had agreed about it.
We just have to explain it to Rikke because exactly. Everything is already done.
Correct, yeah. So that was super challenging, and also, you know, particular team building events and so on was always something very competitive and male dominated. Let's go on a obstacle course where we have to be or run an Ironman or something. And I had no particular interest in taking part of this. I wouldn't say I wouldn't be able to do it, but I was just like, why would I spend my time doing this?
Extremely male. Use your elbows everywhere.
Exactly. Very, very intense in that way. And very, very competitive. And even though
but competitive in a useful way. I mean, were they trying to do their job so well and that they were taking care of the customer or made even did the biggest amount of sales? Or was it a useful way or was it a destructive way?
I would say both. There's also some very, very highly skilled people in London. That's just a fact. Now, when I'm back in Copenhagen, it's a much smaller city and, you know, also very less competitive. So I will say competitiveness also, you know, makes people try even harder. So I will give them that. And there were some very, very smart people in London.
They work very hard and late.
Correct. Yeah. And that also, you know, also gave them some benefits. Having moved back now and been back in Denmark for a year and a half, the work-life balance is better and the whole way of doing business is different. And I think I like that style more, but it's also probably because I'm Scandinavian. But I will say sometimes I do miss a little bit that drive that there is in London with a lot of very, very intelligent people, you know, really going for something.
Thank you very much for sharing.
Yeah,
appreciate. So this was another of those really interesting women you meet here at the European Women Payments Network. Be a member. Men can join.